Well, hello, Faith family, and thanks for joining us for the Wednesday edition of the Daily Connection. And we're still in that theme of call to duty and the idea of spiritual warfare and specifically knowing your enemy. So yesterday, Aaron led us through some verses from John chapter 8. And in those verses, Jesus talks about the nature of Satan. And he even says he's a liar, he's a deceiver, and he does that because it's in his very nature to lie. And I want us to go back today to Genesis chapter 3 and see the first time that we see evil in its appearance in the biblical narrative. Because to this point in chapters 1 and 2, everything's been declared good. Now in chapter 3, something's going to happen. And we're going to see Satan acting out of his nature and how that's so subtle but yet so powerful and how we can combat that. So Genesis chapter 3, let's look in verses 1 through 5. Now the serpent was most cunning of all the wild animals that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you can't eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "What? We may eat from the tree, from the trees in the garden, but about the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden, God said, you must not eat it or touch it, or you'll die." No, you will certainly not die," the serpent said to the woman. "In fact, God knows that when you eat it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Of course, we know the rest of the story. Eve goes on to kind of look closely at the fruit and give it some careful attention and eventually to decide, hey, maybe this is pretty good. And it's all downhill from there. So we come back, first of all, to the statement in verse 1. The serpent was the most cunning of all the wild animals that the Lord God had made. Now, we know that word cunning can't be a negative term. It can't imply evil in and of itself. Why? Because it says the Lord God made. Everything that God made was good. So let me help you understand that word cunning just means one that is keenly aware of danger and able to avoid that danger. So it's just talking about a craftiness of a sense, but not in an evil intent. It's not evil until we see that the serpent obviously has been indwelt by Satan. It's becoming a vehicle, an avenue by which Satan will use to carry out his evil intention. Now, one thing that I know you have to ask yourself this, because I've always asked myself this, was it common for the animals to speak to man and woman? Because Eve doesn't seem to have a problem here. I mean, to me, the first thing we should see in response to the serpent saying, "Did God really say?" is, gotta go. Hey, I'm out of here. And going back to Adam, saying, "Adam, you're not going to believe this, man, but one of the animals talked to me today." And of course, Adam's first reply, "Well, did you talk back? You know, are you crazy?" You know, so we need to understand that the serpent itself is not the evil. It's Satan within the serpent, embodying the serpent, that captures the evil. But then notice how he acts here. Notice how he carries out his ploy. Very subtle, very calculated. "Did God really say you can't eat from any tree in the garden?" Now, if you'll look earlier in verse 1, it says, "wild animals that the Lord God made." Yahweh Elohim, the covenant name. But when the serpent speaks, which is Satan, he says, "Did God Elohim only?" The word typically referring to God as creator. Did God really say you can't eat from any tree in the garden? What it basically means is that Satan's trying to portray him as some bully, some overbearing, preventative measure parent type concept, saying, "Man, God's so restrictive. Man, God doesn't want you to enjoy anything." Trying to get Eve to consider that possibly there's something she's missing. Now, to her credit, Eve responds back, but also notice how she even succumbs to this subtle temptation to move outside of the explicit word of God. Because first of all, well, let me back up for a moment. If you go back to verse 16 of chapter 2, you see that God didn't state it that way. In fact, what God said was the opposite of that. "I've given you every tree except for one." So God stated in a very free, enjoying sense. Satan staying in a very restrictive sense. Well, then Eve comes back and says, "We may eat from the trees in the garden, but..." So we're good so far. "About the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden, God said, you must not eat it or touch it." Now, God didn't say that. God just said, "You must not eat of it." And then he stated the consequence. Now, remember, Adam was the one who received that instruction, not Eve. Eve, according to chapter 2, Eve's not even in the equation yet. She's not even on the scene yet. So Adam received the instruction. So this might have been, he may be the guilty party here. He may be the one who, you know, say, hey, I'm going to take it so far as to tell you, Eve, don't even touch it. I mean, if that's the case, what he should have said is, hey, Eve, we can't eat it. Don't even touch it. Don't even look at it, girl. Move on. We got all this other stuff. Don't even worry about it. But regardless, she kind of adds to it a little bit, and that lets Satan know, I've got her. She doesn't really, truly understand what's going on here. Because he comes back in verse 4, he says, No, don't worry about that. You're not going to die. He's causing her to question the word of God. In fact, he says, God is trying to hold something back from you. God's trying to prevent you from enjoying full knowledge because he knows that the day you eat of it, you will indeed be like him. Now, the idea of your eyes being opened is the idea of gaining an understanding that you didn't previously have. And I've heard it explained before that what they will gain is not knowing good and evil, because there was already something of a knowledge of good and evil. Instead, it's more of a determination of good and evil, because only God, being holy and righteous, can declare what is good. And then, of course, anything opposite of that would be naturally evil. Only God can do that. So it's almost as saying, hey, then you will be the one who will get to determine what you get to do and what you don't get to do. You won't have all these prohibitions, all these restrictions. But basically what it boils down to is this, friends. One of Satan's most powerful tools is to get you to question the Word of God. First of all, to catch you in a sense of you don't know the Word accurately, causing you to question the accuracy of the Word of God, but most importantly, getting you to question an understanding because you don't understand the Word accurately as it's given to us in Scripture. Then, once that comes into play, then you begin to question motive. Well, why would God restrict such a thing? Why would God prevent me from being happy? Doesn't God want me to be happy? Well, yeah, God indeed wants it to be good. He wants us to enjoy the creation, but he said we must enjoy it within the realm of his determined purpose, not in our distorted plans for that purpose. And so we've got to be intentional when it comes to the deception of Satan. We've got to make sure we study the Word of God, make sure we understand it accurately, and then make sure we apply it faithfully. And when we do that, friends, that means that not only do we know the Word of God here, that we're convicted about the Word of God here, and we submit to that authority, which is what Adam and Eve did not do. Because if they had, they would have rejected Satan, they would have rebuked the words, they would have understood it correctly, and they would have resisted. Satan's a deceiver, and he's very subtle. So, I don't know what's going on with you this week. It's Wednesday, it's hump day, da-da-da, but you know what? Don't let your circumstances and situations determine your demeanor. Instead, by the power of the Word of God and by the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit of God, you determine to be different. You determine to portray a personality and a persona that is Christ-centered, that is God-honoring, and we do that as we're faithful to live sent.